السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله، أحمدك ربي حق حمدك، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، لا شريك لك في ملكك، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبدك ورسولك. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وزد وبارك عليه وعلى آل بيته وأصحابه ومن استنى بسنته واقتفى أثره ودعا بدعوته إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، الإمام مسلم رحمه الله reported a hadith narrated by أبو فراس ربيعة ابن كعب الأسلمي. Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Aslami is one of the companions. He narrated only in his entire life four ahadith. He used to come and sit in front of the door of the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He said himself that he used to sit this way to serve Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam if he needed anything. If Prophet Muhammad ﷺ woke up for the Salah, Rabi'a will run to bring water for Rasulullah ﷺ to make wudu. If the Prophets need anything, Rabi'a is always offering himself. So the Prophet ﷺ wanted to pay him back, to do something to him also. So the Prophet told him ﷺ, "Sal ma shi'at. If you need something, ask me. I give you whatever you want. You're always helping, you're always serving. Also, I want to do something for you." So he was thinking, the Prophet ﷺ is telling me what you want. If I ask him for anything, he will give it to me. So I need to think of something important to ask for. After thinking, he came to the Prophet and said, "O Messenger of Allah, أسألك مرافقتك في الجنة. I'm asking you to be in your company in Jannah." So the Prophet said, "Awa ghayra dhak? Don't you ask about something else?" He asked it for something very, very great, very expensive. The Prophet said, "Ala inna sil'at Allah ghaliya, ala inna sil'at Allah al Jannah." So the Prophet himself who said Jannah is very expensive. So he said to the Prophet, I wanna be in your company in Jannah." So the Prophet said, "Awa ghayra dhak? Don't you ask for something else? Ask for food, I give you. Ask for clothes, I give you. If you ask for dabba, you can give him camel or horse or something. Il jannah." He said, "Awa ghayra dhak? Qala huwa dhaka ya Rasulullah." Nothing else. I don't need anything else except to be with you in Jannah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was thinking. Then he said, "أعني على نفسك بكثرة السجود." Help me to get you with me by making a lot of prayers, a lot of prostrations. So if you are prostrating a lot, you will be with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Jannah. So when you pray two rak'at before Fajr and two rak'at Fajr, and you pray Salat al-Duha, you pray rak'at before Salat al-Dhuhr, then you pray Salat al-Dhuhr, then you pray salawat nawafil after salat al-dhuhr, then you do salawat between adhan and iqama, then you do two rak'at after maghrib after you do maghrib, then you do two rak'at after isha after you do isha, then you do 11 rak'ah with the imam in the taraweeh, then you come again in the last third of the night to do another 11 rak'ah with the imam. All these prostrations will make you qualified to be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. Is it a good deal? Do you think it's a good deal to prostrate a lot to be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? There is a companion, his name is Thawban. He used to be called the Thawban al-Nabawi. He used to love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to be with him all the time. And one day the Prophet saw him skinny, looks weak. You can see his face yellow. So the Prophet ﷺ asked about him, maybe he is sick or something. So he said to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, I did not see you for a day. Daytime and nighttime. The Prophet was outside the city, so he did not see him for a day. So he missed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to this level. Imagine a person missed the Prophet because he did not see him for a day. Daytime and nighttime. Yani with our language, 24 hours. His face became yellow. His body appeared weak. And subhanallah, he told the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, I always miss you. O Messenger of Allah, I always miss you. I'm always thinking that in the day of judgment, even if I will enter al-Jannah, I'm not gonna be with you. Because you will be in the level of the prophets. So I'm not gonna be with you. So he is not thinking only to enter al-Jannah. No, he is worried that after he enters al-Jannah, he is not gonna be happy because he's not gonna be with the prophet in the same level. So Allah Almighty revealed the verse in the Quran. In this verse he said, وَمَا يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. Whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. So those who obey Allah and His Messenger will be in the company of, count with me. Allah said in the verse 4, categories of people. فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ. So that means if you are obedient to Allah and His Messenger, you will be with the prophets. مَعَ النَّبِيِّينَ. وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ. You will be with the righteous people. Those who believed in the prophets, their companions, الْحَوَارِيُّونَ. وَالصَّالِحِينَ. وَالشُّهَدَاءِ. مع الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. Also with the martyrs and the righteous people. You will be with the prophets and the companions of the prophets and the martyrs and the righteous people. All these people will be in Jannah together in the same level. Only you need to obey Allah Azza wa Jal and to obey the Messenger. Only you need to make a lot of prostrations, a lot of salawat. It is reported in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, a hadith narrated by two different companions, a narration by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and another narration by Anas ibn Malik. In the narration of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Mas'ud said that a man asked Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, O Messenger of Allah, ما قولك في الرجل يحب القوم ولم يلحق بهم. He said, O Messenger of Allah, what do you say in a person, he loves the people but he is not able to catch them? Different speed. He loves the prophet, he loves the companions, he loves the martyrs, he loves the Muslims, but he is not able to catch. There is difference in the speed, right? There are people are fast and there are people slow, right? So he's asking the Prophet, what do you say? I love the Muslims, I love the prophets, but I'm not able to catch them. And when I pray, I'm not able to pray like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He used to do his rak'ah, one rak'ah with al-Baqarah, Ali Imran, النساء and one rak'ah. Imagine if he's praying 11 rak'ah, how much Quran he's reciting and how many hours he's spending. I love him, but I'm not able to catch him. He's too fast. So the Prophet said the good news. He said, "Al-mar'u ma'a man ahab." The person will be with the one he loves. If you love a person, you will be with him. But if you really love him, if your love is a true love, not fake love. In the same Bukhari and Muslim, from the narration of Anas, Anas narrated that a man came to Prophet Muhammad and said, O Messenger of Allah, when the hour? O Messenger of Allah, when the hour will start? When the judgment day will start? So the Prophet answered the question by raising another question. He told them in return, what did you prepare for it? You're asking about the hour, you're asking about the judgment day. Are you ready for it? So the man said, O Messenger of Allah, I did not prepare a lot of good deeds. Yani, I'm not able to match you. I'm not able to match Abu Bakr and Umar. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I did not prepare that much of good deed, except that I love Allah and His Messenger. I love Allah and His Messenger. I have this. So the Prophet said, Al-mar'u ma'a man ahabba yawm al-qiyamah. The person will be with those who love in the day of resurrection. The point here, do we really love Allah and His Messenger? Because if we are making this claim, Allah will ask us about the proof of it. In the Quran, Allah said, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Right? So if you go to any of the scholars and ask him, what are the proofs of love? If I want to prove my love to Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, if I want to prove my love to Allah Azza wa Jal, what do I need to do? You will be told, be obedient. Be obedient. Obey Allah and obey the Messenger. When you are making decisions between Allah and anything else, choose Allah. When you are making decisions between the Prophet and anything else, choose the Prophet. If you are making choice between what you love and what Allah loves, do what Allah loves. If you are making choice between what you love and what the Prophet loves, do what the Prophet loves. Leave what you desire and love what Allah legislated. These are the proofs of love. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Bring your proofs if you're really truthful. If you said I love Allah, automatically you'll be obeying Him. Automatically. تَعْصِي الْإِلَهَ وَأَنْتَ تَزْعُمُ حُبَّهُ. هَذَا لَعَمْرُ اللَّهِ فِي الْقِيَاسِ شَنِيعُ. You disobey Allah and you claim that you love Him? Doesn't make sense. So the sign of your love to Allah is your obedience. The sign of your love to Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is your obedience. I will tell you to which level. There is a man, he used to be called Dhu Al-Bijadain. Dhu Al-Bijadain. So this man, he was living in the house of his uncle raised him. So he went to his uncle and told him, I'm coming to take your permission to be Muslim. I want to announce my Islam. I want to join Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and I want to migrate with him to Medina. So his uncle told him, no, I'm not going to allow you to do that. But Dhul Bijadain, he's in love with the Prophet. He loves the Prophet. He loves this deen. He loves Allah Azza wa Jal. He believed in the truth. So he told his uncle, I'm going anyway, whether you agree or disagree. I wanted to go with your permission. But if you do not want me to go, I will go anyway. So his uncle told him, okay, that means you will go with nothing with you. We will take everything from you. They took his house. They took his money. They took even his animals. They took his clothes. They took his clothes off. Even the clothes that he's putting on. Then they gave him only bijadain, something to cover his lower part and something to cover his upper part. And he migrated like this. See the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nobody asked us to give up our houses. Nobody asked us to give up our clothes or give up our money completely. These people were tested to this level, to give up everything related to dunya. To go behind Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. They went. When Prophet Muhammad saw him ﷺ, he asked him, why? Why is he wearing like this? So he told the Prophet what happened with him from his uncle. So the Prophet ﷺ told him, Rabbi Halbayah. This is the great deal, the best commerce with Allah Azza wa Jal, the best trade profitable trade with Allah Azza wa Jal. Then he called him Dhul Bijadain because he used to wear the two Bijadain to cover his body. So my brothers and sisters, Ramadan is coming as a training camp for us, a school of piety for us to do and to train ourselves and to grow our ability to obey Allah and His Messenger gradually. Alhamdulillah, we are now listening to part 30 from the Quran, the final part. We will complete the entire Quran tomorrow, inshallah ta'ala. In Ramadan, if we will have 2-3 more days, maybe 4 at max, and there is no more Ramadan this year. So it is our chance in these 3-4 days to make the best of our worship at the end of Ramadan. Because you must conclude with the best thing you are able to do. Don't get lazy. Because usually the brothers, once the Quran is finished, they think Ramadan's finished. No, Ramadan still. And as much as you go toward the end, the blessing is more and the reward is greater. So keep thinking of every minute you are receiving now is greater than every minute you passed. The best of everything, the end of everything. So make the best of the end of Ramadan, the best of your worship, inshallah ta'ala. And before we call the Imam to continue the Salah, just I want to tell you two things. Number one, regarding Zakat al-Fitr. It is very important to make sure that you are giving Zakat al-Fitr correctly, in a right way. So we spoke about Zakat al-Fitr in the class after Salat al-Asr, explained the fiqh of it. But there is something important to know for your zakah to be delivered to the poor in a proper time, and it will be considered a valid zakah and accepted inshallah ta'ala from you. If you are giving your zakah by your hand to the poor, no problem. The only thing you need to give it before Salat al-Eid. Before Salat al-Eid, not after. Because after Salat al-Eid, you lost the time. And if you are asking the masjid to deliver your zakah, you need to make an intention that you need the masjid to give your zakah, and you need to give wakala to the masjid, to make the masjid your wakil, your representative. And to give him this as soon as possible for them to be able to buy the food and to find the poor and to deliver it before Eid. Most of the people, they wait until 1 hour before Salat al-Eid and come throw their money and go away. So what we're gonna do with this money? We have only 1 hour before Salat al-Eid, right? So if you want the masjid to, anyway your money will be delivered. Even if you bring it 1 week after the Eid, we will deliver it. We have no other choice. But for you, for your zakat to be valid and to be accepted and to be considered Zakat al-Fitr, it must arrive to the hand of the poor before Salat al-Eid. So if you want the masjid to be your wakil, don't wait for last minute. Give the zakah early, or at least give the wakala to the masjid for them to be able to do the job. My second thing I want to say regarding the gaps in the rows in the salah. Some brothers, they bring a chair to the middle of the row. So he's standing in the row and he's putting a chair behind him. So this chair makes a big hole in the other row, so the row is not connected, and this is not the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Our Prophet taught us to make the row of the salah like a wall, standing close to each other, no gaps. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam offered reward for the one who will fill up the gap or close the gap. There's a great reward for that, to close the gap. So for that, everybody put in a chair behind him. He doesn't care about the other row. And sometimes it's a big space between every two Muslims. We don't pray this way. We need to fix the row and not to leave gaps in the middle. No corona anymore. Corona is just exception. If you want to sit on the chair, there are rows of chairs in the back. Don't bring the chair to the first row and second row. And we said before, no reservation in the rows. You come early, you deserve the spot in the first row. If you are not early, don't take the spot of somebody else. Final thing, tomorrow inshallah on the night of 27, usually every year We make fundraising during the night. The effort was the rebuilding of the masjid. Alhamdulillah, the masjid finished. Alhamdulillah. And we raised the money after that for the debt of the construction. And the good news, we finished the debt. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Only one thing remained, that we will need to make elevator. We did not make elevator when we built the masjid because we wanted to open the masjid. If you stay until you make elevator, you need more money, more time, too much inspections, especially if elevator takes a lot of inspections. So the board was under pressure to finish quickly and to open the masjid because the community needed the masjid. They stayed for about 6 years plus waiting for the reopening of the masjid. So they decided to open the masjid first, then we do the fundraising later on, the elevator later on. So inshallah ta'ala, tomorrow I will be standing after Salat al-Isha to ask you to pay the money of the elevator. So before you come for the Salah, make sure don't miss your book, your checkbook. Okay? Your card is okay. Envelope of cash is okay also. I'll be nice with you. Write pledge and bring the money next day, no problem. Okay? But don't come tomorrow without the check, because we need to collect the money of the elevator one time and finish. I don't want to keep talking about this situation many times. And we cannot start the installation of the elevator if we don't have the entire budget in hand. If you have 50% of the money, we're not going to be able just to make a hole in the masjid and keep it open. Once you work, you need to finish. So we're not going to take the first step until we have the budget in the hand. So everything will be explained tomorrow, inshallah, in the Taraweeh. But I'm telling you to come. You know that not because the masjid is open, no more fundraisings in Ramadan. We have fundraising, inshallah, on the night of 27. And we, inshallah, bi-iznillah, we will collect the budget of the elevator tomorrow, inshallah ta'ala, together. Tomorrow you will know how much, inshallah. But bring the fat check with you. Big fat one. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم سبحانك اللهم ربنا وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والحمد لله